So, welcome everyone. My name is Tom Kane. I'm a faculty director of the Center for Education Policy Research at the Harvard Graduate School of Education. This seminar today is co-hosted with the Inequality and Social Policy Program at the Kennedy School. For those of you who are maybe joining us from the Inequality and Social Policy Program, this seminar series is part of a IES-funded pre-doctoral program to help young researchers get more connected with school districts and state education agencies to do research. So we're very lucky to have Sean Reardon, a professor of education, a professor of poverty and inequality in education from Stanford here with us. Sean is one of the intellectual leaders internationally in understanding the causes, patterns, trends, and consequences of social and educational inequality. Today, he'll be presenting a paper on the sources of geographic variation in the black, white, and white, Hispanic achievement gap around the United States. He's also giving a seminar tomorrow in the sociology department on a different topic. So if you want to, if you want to see Sean present another one of his, you know, many papers in this area tomorrow, would be a good chance while we've got him here. So Sean, let's welcome Sean back to Cambridge.
Thank you, Tom, and thanks for the invitation, and thank you all for coming. It's like old home week because I sat in these seats right here and took S30 with Judy Singer back in, I won't tell you back in when, but you know, it was a while ago. They've remodeled it since I was here, but it's nice to be back. I'm going to tell you about this work I've been doing for the last few years with Andrew Ho as my main collaborator on this, and I also just want to thank Andrew because he's one of the best collaborators one could have, and it's just been a joy to work with you, and it's been a really fun project in part because of that. I'm going to talk today about kind of the geography of educational inequality and inequality of educational opportunity in the United States. I'm going to talk tomorrow in the social department about segregation, school and residential segregation, and the role they play in educational outcomes. So I'm say a few things about segregation today, but if that's a thing you're interested in and you can bear to listen to me talk for another hour, I'll be in the social department doing that tomorrow. So when I was a graduate student here, one of the things I learned from Sarah Lawrence Lightfoot, who was on my dissertation committee, and I learned this from watching you, Sarah, was to start a lecture with a story. And I suspect you've all seen Sarah do that quite well. So when I was 22, after I graduated from college, I went and taught high school on an Indian reservation in Pine Ridge, South Dakota. Pine Ridge was then and still is now the poorest county in the United States, 85% unemployment, 90% poverty, a part of America we don't pay much attention to and that is largely sort of forgotten and impoverished, but also a sort of a wonderful place with wonderful people. And I learned a lot about teaching, but also just a lot about myself there. And then I went from there after 2 years, and I taught in Morristown, New Jersey at a Quaker school. And Morristown, for those of you from New Jersey, is an affluent suburb sort of outside of Philadelphia. And I was 24 years old, and I could not have been more struck by the vast disparity in the kinds of opportunities, the communities, the schools that the kids in Pine Ridge had versus what the kids had in Morristown, New Jersey. And I spent a lot of time then thinking about why there were such differences in opportunities and differences in the sort of outcomes for kids. And I've essentially been thinking about that same question for the last 25 years. When I was a graduate student, I thought about it a lot, and I did an ethnographic dissertation, a study of kids growing up in a working class community and kids growing up in a rich community. And that's essentially what I'm going to be talking about today. When I did it in graduate school, I was dealing with an N of two communities, and now we're going to talk about an N of 200 million. But it's the same question approached from a somewhat different angle, and the same sort of animating questions for me underlie it, and I think are still as relevant now as they were 25 years ago, or have been really for all of American history. And so here's sort of the animating questions. I'm really interested in how much educational outcomes and disparities in outcomes vary across communities in the United States, and in particular, why do they vary? Do they vary? Obviously, they vary because of differences in the opportunities kids have, but do those opportunities reside primarily in home environments, in neighborhood conditions, in preschool opportunities, in K-12 schools, in out-of-school factors, after-school programs? What is it that leads to these differences in opportunities? And then finally, what can we do about it? Where are the sort of levers to improve opportunity for kids who don't have as much as others? Should we help families? Should we improve neighborhoods? Should we improve schools, preschool? What should we do? I'm going to give you an answer to the first question today. I'm going to give you sort of a partial answer to the second one, and I'm not going to really have any answer for the third one today, just to not to set expectations sufficiently low. So when we want to study educational outcomes, one of the outcomes that are readily available are test scores. Now, test scores are certainly not the only thing we think schools should be producing. Maybe they're actually a thing we think schools shouldn't be producing, but they are readily available, and so they are a way of kind of measuring one dimension of the kind of outcomes of children's experiences up until, middle school or high school. The problem is that in every state in the United States, we administer different standardized tests, and those tests are different in different grades. They change sometimes from one year to the next, and they're also not scored or scaled in at all the same way. Under No Child Left Behind, states had to give tests in grades 3 through 8 and then in high school, and they had to report students' test scores, but they had to report how many students were proficient, and they all got to decide what proficient meant. So you have about 600 different definitions of proficient in a given year, because you have 50 states doing it. They're doing it in 6 different grades and 2 different subjects. So even just sort of comparing proficiency rates is sort of inadequate. So this makes the comparison of outcomes, even on a single measure like test scores, quite complicated. And I'm not going to go into how we solve this problem in detail today, except to sort of summarize it in one slide. So Andrew and I have been working on this problem for a few years, and essentially our solution is this. We take the test scores from every school or every school district, and we determine how the test scores on average of students in that school compare to those in their same grade and subject and state. So where does the Cambridge Public Schools third grade math scores fall relative to the Massachusetts third grade math scores in the same year? Then we compare the statewide distribution of test scores in grades 4 and 8 to the NAEP distribution of test scores in grades 4 and 8. So NAEP is given in every state in grades 4 and 8 and every other year. It's the same test, so it provides a way to align states' scores relative to one another. We standardize the scores for the stuff I'll show you today to represent sort of grade equivalents. It's not psychometrically the best thing, and it's not what I would say the version of our scores you should use for research, but it's a version that's very, very highly correlated with the sort of standardized scores and better for sort of presentation. So that's why I'm going to use those today. And then for what I'm going to show you today, we're going to average across all the grades and the subjects and the years that we have data for, just so there's a single number for every school district. But the data we have is much more detailed than that. And then we're going to link it to data on schools and communities from other data sources. We have a bunch of papers that describe how we do this available on the project's website, ceta.stanford.edu. And all the data that I'm going to show you today is publicly available on our website as well, or will soon. Some of it's not yet up there, but will soon be up there. Part of what we're trying to do is make this data a public good so that other researchers and educators, policymakers can sort of use it to understand these patterns. So the data that I'm going to show you today is based on about 215 million test scores taken by every child in grades 3 to 8 in a public school in the United States from 2009 to 2013. 5 years of data spanning 6 grades in every single public school in the United States. We have the data broken down by race and ethnicity and economic disadvantage and also gender. I'll show you some of that today as well. And we've, as I sort of briefly described a second ago, we've put the test scores on this sort of common scale so that they're roughly comparable across school districts that are in different states, grades, and years. And then we've linked this to data on the demographic characteristics of the community. So the American Community Survey, which is the long form of the census now, asks parents whether their children, how old their children are, whether they're in school, whether they're in public or private school, and then gets various family information. And so this ACS reports the data tabulated in exactly the way we want it. That is, they report tabulations for every school district in the United States of the characteristics of families who have school-age children enrolled in public school living in that district, right? So that the demographic data we have doesn't include families who are enrolled in private schools, for example. It doesn't include people who don't have kids. It just includes the families who have kids in public schools. So it's the population of families that whose children's test scores are represented in the data. We also have data from things like the Common Core of data and other sources of data that we can link to these data. And you could download all the data and you could link it to any other source of data you have. It has, the school districts are named, they have all their regular IDs and everything. So it's a fully public data set, and if you want, I'll tell you the gory detail about the logistics and politics of getting the data and making it public. But right now, what you need to know is that it is public. And the other thing I will say is that we're going to be adding more data to what's up there. What's up there now is district level data. We also have the data tabulated by metropolitan area, by county, by commuting zone, and by race, ethnicity, gender, and economic disadvantage within every school district. Those data will be posted probably in April, once we finish sort of the final checking and verification of them all. We also have data at the school level. That is, what I'm going to show you today is district level data, but the data exist at the school level by grade, by subgroup, and we will, as we finish doing the cleaning and the validation and whatnot, we'll put those data up so you'll be able to see, for example, what's the average test scores of children of say Latino children in third grade in math in Cesar Chavez Elementary School in 2013, right? Not student level data, but it's grade by subgroup, by year, by subject, by school level data. So it's quite detailed, and it's population data, so it's any school you are interested in looking at, you can look at. We also have the data I'm going to show you today only goes through 2013. We'll put up also the 13, 14, and 14, 15 school years of data, which include the Smarter Balanced and PARC assessment data as states start to use those. And our plan is to keep doing this future. That is, we sort of think of this as we're building, I think of it as like we're building a telescope, right? So that's several orders of magnitude higher resolution than the telescopes we currently have. That is, it lets you look at these patterns of outcomes at a very, very fine level of aggregation and detail. And the idea is to make that instrument, that telescope, sort of publicly available so that lots of people can use it to learn from it, not just us, because there's far more that one could think of ways to learn from it than what Andrew and I and our teams can think of to do with it. So that's my sort of quick summary of the data and an advertisement. Hope that you will all make use of it in interesting ways. But now let me show you what we see in the data. I should also say I'm happy to take questions as we go along. I don't know what your norm in here is for interrupting. As long as it's not hostile, I'm fine with it. All right, so the final caveat I would say about this is I'm going to tell you about what test scores are in every school district in the United States. And the way I think of what the test scores are is that they're not solely the product of what happens in schools. They're the product of all the opportunities children have had to learn the material on the test up until that time. So I think of them as measures of opportunity, not measures of school quality. So if you go to greatschools.org or something, they will tell you that the test scores are a measure of the quality of schools in that place. I think, as you all, I suspect, also think that's probably an inappropriate way to interpret test scores there. But I think it's useful to think of them as a reasonable proxy for the sort of sum total of educational opportunities that children in a given place have had. And the other thing to keep in mind is they're not measures of intelligence, right? These are measures of performance. They're measures of what students have taught and what they've learned and how much of that they're able to perform on a standardized test under the conditions of standardized tests. So take them with all those caveats in mind. But I think that they still tell us something very useful about the differences in opportunity among places. What they don't by themselves do is tell us what the sources of those differences of opportunity are. They don't tell us whether those sources are from differences in the quality of teaching or the curriculum or the neighborhoods or the families or anything like that, right? So they have some strengths, but we shouldn't overinterpret them. So the way I'm going to describe test scores today is imagine that we have a national average of what test scores are, and we've scaled it so that this is what the national average looked like. If you're in third grade, the average student in the United States scores at a third grade level, right? And in fourth grade, at fourth grade level. This is the way we've defined the scale. So if we look at different districts, we can sort of compute a trajectory of students in that district. So here's three example school districts. So in Chicago, the average student in third grade is scoring about a grade or more below the national average. That is, they're well below average. Baltimore, scoring about a half grade level below average. In Union City, New Jersey, they're scoring slightly above the national average. I picked these three because they're roughly similar in socioeconomic conditions, though they obviously differ in other ways. But in Chicago, children actually improve their test scores over from third to eighth grade much faster than the national average. By eighth grade, test scores in Chicago are almost at the national average. In Baltimore, the opposite is true. They sort of fall further behind, so that by eighth grade, test scores in Baltimore are two grades below the national average. And Union City, they sort of maintain this sort of position relative to the national average, slightly above the national average all the way along. We estimate this kind of a trajectory for every school district based on the five years of data and the six grades of data and the two subjects. So it's sort of pooling all of that up. You can do it with the data at a finer level. But for today, I'm going to sort of show two things. I'm going to focus on what's the average level of the district's performance relative to the national average, and what's the slope of this trajectory? How fast are test scores improving relative to the national average?
Sean, should we interpret that as a change for individual cohorts?
It's estimated as a within cohort change. So essentially what we do is we say third graders in 2009, fourth graders in 2010, fifth graders in 2011. The caveat here is this will be affected if a school district retains a whole lot of kids in grade, then it's going to sort of look like there's faster growth maybe than there is in reality, because this isn't, we're not basing on individuals test scores, we're basing it on kind of cohort level test scores.
And the average is that student weighted for the US average?
Yes, that is the population average for the whole country, based essentially on NAEP.
So will you say a little more at some point about the implications of using district as the unit of analysis?
Yeah, let me say that now, actually, because I meant to say that, so thank you. So why do we use the district? Well, first of all, let me be clear what I mean by a district. I mean not an administrative school district, I mean a geographic school district. And the distinction there is really about charter schools. So when I say Boston public schools, I mean all the schools that are within the geographic boundaries of the Boston public school district. So that includes all the traditional third through eighth grade public schools in Boston, all the charter schools that are chartered by Boston and that fall under its administrative umbrella, that is, that have the same district code in the NCS data, as well as all charters that are chartered not by the district, but by the state or whatever agency charters them in a particular place, but that sit geographically in the boundaries of the Boston Public Schools. The reason I'm going to show you that is because I'm thinking of the school system in a place as a feature of a community. I'm not so much interested in the administrative logic of it, right? Who runs the school, who's responsible for looking at the budget or hiring and firing the teachers, but if you grow up in this community, what's the set of schooling opportunities available to you? That is going to include traditional public schools, charter schools, right? The only thing we don't have here is private schools. And so we're going to then compare the performance of kids in that geographic district's public schools to the family backgrounds of the kids who send their kids to public schools in that geographic boundary. So a district here is a geographic entity or a geographic community, not an administrative entity. That's one thing to keep in mind. We will, when we release the school level data, you'll be able to identify which are charters and which aren't, because you could consolidate them out back into whatever the administrative units are, if that was the relevant way to do it for your questions, but that's not what I'm doing here. So the reason I'm doing districts is because the bigger reason why districts is think of the opportunities that are available to you if you grow up in this community. And so I think of the school system in a community as the kind of relevant organizational entity, not so much the individual school that you sort of grow up next to, because in lots of places where you grow up isn't, you know, which school is sort of closest to you is not the sum total of your kind of public schooling opportunities, right? So for a set of questions about communities and how they shape opportunities, I think the geographic district is the entity of interest. For other kinds of questions, the school may be the entity of interest, or the county, or the state, or, you know, obviously there's sort of different ways to slice it. The nice thing about having population level data is you don't have to slice it the way we slice it. You could slice it sort of any way you want. Is that satisfying?
Yeah. I was thinking about the fact that there's going to be enormous variation in size here, and in addition, district boundaries are defined differently, say, in the South.
Right. So certainly one could refine this to take in some of that into account. The size piece is going to be evident in the pictures I show you. And even in the smallest district we have, so we're not allowed to report data for any cell smaller than 20 students. So if a district only had 19 students in each grade, we couldn't report data for it because there's no grade that's reportable. But if it only has 20 students per grade, we have six grades and 5 years and two subjects. We have 1,200 test scores for that. For the smallest district in the data, still has an enormous amount of information. So we get very precise estimates of the average performance in a place, even if it's a small place. So there's not a problem here with imprecision. But there may be analytic questions where we are focused more on larger or smaller places, and you could certainly slice the data that way. So this is a map of I like to think of it as a map of educational opportunity in the United States, which is different than school quality in the United States. That is, this is the average test scores in each district in the country on a scale where the darkest green is 2.5 grade levels or more above the national average, and the darkest purple is 2.5 grade levels or more below the national average. So 2.5 grade levels is a little less than a standard deviation if you're sort of comfortable thinking about these things in standard deviation units. So either way, whether you want to think of it in grade levels or standard deviations, there's a very, very big range of differences in educational outcomes and therefore in opportunities. The Deep South and large parts of the West are in purple, which means relatively low test scores. Lots of New England and various other largely suburban places around the country are the places with the highest test scores. This probably isn't that surprising. If you've seen a map of poverty in the United States, this is kind of what it looks like. So this is now that same data, but now scaled or compared to the average socioeconomic conditions of the families in each community. Remember, the families who have kids in public school. So this is a composite measure, an index based on family incomes, parents' education levels, poverty rates, single-parent household rates, unemployment rates, and SNAP eligibility rates. And so we take all of those measures for the families who have kids in the public schools. We create a summary index of them that's standardized. So one is one standard deviation away. So these are the affluent places. These are the very poor places. There's a lot of variation in the United States in community poverty or affluence. And it's enormously highly correlated with the set of educational opportunities that are available. So the correlation here at the district level is about 0.82. Now that doesn't mean the kid level correlation is high. The kid level correlation is about 0.4. All right, because obviously in each of these districts there are high performing and lower performing kids. But the district at the aggregate district level, knowing the average socioeconomic characteristics of the community tells you an awful lot about the average performance and therefore the opportunities of kids in that community. But that said, there's still a lot of variation. If we pick, all the school districts in the country that are sort of average socioeconomic status, they still vary, by well over two or grade levels or more difference, right? So even among places that are the same, we have a lot of difference in outcomes. That says sort of socioeconomic conditions aren't destiny. They're really powerful, but they aren't everything. And what accounts for the remainder here is I think a really interesting question. But also, what accounts for this correlation? That is, what is it about the affluent communities that provides more opportunity? Is it just because those communities have parents who read more to their kids and have more income to provide them with cognitively stimulating and developmentally appropriate activities and more time because they have two earners or whatnot? Or is it because they're able to attract much better teachers to their school and pay them more, and so they're able to provide a much better K-12 system? Or do they have much better preschool systems or safer neighborhoods? What's the sort of active ingredient driving that is, I think, the sort of million-dollar question, right? And then the billion-dollar question is, what do you do about it? Where's the levers to actually sort of change that? So let me show you some more. So this is Union City, Chicago, and Baltimore. I showed you before. They're all roughly equally poor. Union City has sort of slightly above average performance. Chicago and Baltimore lower. By the way, the size of the circles on all these figures is sort of proportional to the enrollment. So that's a way to kind of focus your eye on the big places if you want to. This is the 100 largest school districts in the United States. There's an enormous amount of variation in the large districts around the country in terms of socioeconomic conditions. Some of these out here are sort of like the affluent suburban counties of Washington, D.C. and Virginia, like Loudoun County, right? There's some big suburban countywide school districts that are quite affluent, high test scores. This is Cleveland and this is Detroit. They are three standard deviations below the mean in terms of socioeconomic status in the United States. So that puts them at about the 99th, or about the first percentile, or the 99th percentile of poverty. So those are places that are extraordinarily poor by U.S. standards, and have test scores that are, you know, two and a half standard deviations below the national average. So, but the other thing to notice is that even among the big districts, there's considerable heterogeneity among similar ones. So this is New York, this is Los Angeles, this is Chicago, this is Miami, or maybe that's Miami, Houston. I don't forget which is which. I haven't memorized all of them. But the difference between Los Angeles and New York is over a grade level. They're equally, they're sort of relatively equal in terms of socioeconomic status and size. That suggests at scale there is something that provides lots more opportunity to kids in New York than to Los Angeles. That seems worth understanding.
Have you tried adjusting the affluence for cost of living?
No. So one could do that. I would encourage you to do that. That's often my answer. One could do that. Obviously, there's lots of different ways to think about doing that. I'm not sure it would change the story dramatically, though it might move some places, around on the figure. And when you're using things like median income and poverty rates, you got some slippage on the cost of living issues. Yeah. So here's the comparison of Massachusetts and California. So the white dots are every school district in California, and the red dots are every district in Massachusetts. So we all know that Massachusetts does well on the NAEP and on all, you know, standardized tests. We know it's at the top. But the fact here is it's consistently higher than the national average. Every district almost in Massachusetts is above the national average for districts of their same socioeconomic conditions. And California, we know, doesn't do well, but it's sort of, particularly California doesn't have high performance among the low and middle income school districts in California. When you get to the affluent part of California, the Palo Altos and the Cupertinos and those places, performance in those places is at or above the national average generally, and roughly similar to what it is in the Concords and Wellesleys and Lexingtons of Massachusetts, which are, you know, the places up here, right? So Massachusetts does well nationally, not just because of those places, but it does well nationally because even the big districts in Massachusetts have much higher performance than comparable districts around the country. So that's Springfield, which is quite poor by Massachusetts standards, but also by national standards. Lawrence and Lowell are down here as well. Boston, Cambridge, Arlington, you know, you get up into the sort of Boston affluent suburbs. But across the board, they're sort of doing better than the national average. So what's the story in Massachusetts isn't just one of the kind of Boston suburban ring driving the train. It's the whole state. And it says it's that some of the variation around this line isn't just because of things that individual communities are doing. It's something that's happening at a state level. That is, there are features of some states that are systematically reducing or systematically improving opportunities for kids. Not all of it, but some of the story has to be at this kind of larger level of aggregation.
Sean, what can you say about the variance in test score distributions across rich versus poor districts or different states? My total guess would be there's more variance in low income districts across the country than in high income. Is that true?
Well, if you just look at this, it sort of looks like there's more variance among low-income districts than among affluent ones. It's actually a very tiny difference when you do it. I mean, it's partly there's just a few more outliers here, and so there's not a very big difference in the variability, though there is some. I haven't looked in detail across states at the variability. Though I'll show you a little bit of a different kind of variability among the states. But certainly one could look more into that. The other thing I should say that the data have on them is the not just the average test score in every district, but the amount of variance in test scores within the district. That is, we have an estimate not just of what the average kid is, but is everyone kind of around that, or is there a huge amount of variation? And so that's in the publicly available data, though I'm not going to show it to you today. So one thing people often ask about California is, are the scores here low because California has lots of immigrant students, second language learners, who aren't performing well on standardized tests because of language issues, not because of actual content knowledge. So if we look at Texas, which is sort of a useful comparison to California in this, because it has relatively similar proportions and populations of immigrant students, second language learners, California still looks pretty bad compared to Texas, where things are much better. And if we can adjust the California numbers to sort of control for the proportion of students who are English learners, that only improves their relative standing a little bit. In general, California test scores are low, and they're sort of low throughout the middle and low income part of the income distribution, and that's not because they have a lot of English learners in the school. That's true of the native-speaking white students, as it is true of the immigrant students. So whatever's going wrong in California, we can't blame Mexico. Right? So one thing that does vary interestingly across states, David, this a little bit to your question, is the steepness of this slope on this, that is how strongly is socioeconomic conditions related to educational opportunities. So in Virginia, for example, which is the state here in red, that gradient, that the strength of the relationship between socioeconomic conditions and test scores is about half of what it is in California. So there's not as much difference between how well kids in poor communities perform relative to kids in rich communities in Virginia as there is in California or Massachusetts, for that matter. So something in Virginia seems to create a more equal set of opportunities, whether it's because they have a more progressive funding policy or whether there's other features about the state. One of the things about doing this is I learned how much I don't know about the rest of the country, right? Because every time I look at this, I'm like, oh, what's that place? And then I look at it and I think, I have no idea what goes on in Steubenville, Ohio or something, right? So I don't know what is going on in Virginia, but it's a more equalizing place than California is, or than Massachusetts is, for that matter, right? Though I will say, if you look at this curve, so this red line for Virginia is an average from the third through eighth grade scores. If you drew that line just for third grade scores in Virginia, it's even flatter. It has a slope of about 0.3. If you draw it for eighth grade, it's got a slope that's about 0.7 or 0.8. That is, things start out much more equal in third grade in Virginia, but they kind of quickly start to look more unequal. So whatever is doing the equalizing in Virginia, it suggests it's something that's happening sort of before third grade, and that what's happening after that is more disequalizing.
Is that a regional pattern at all, or is it just idiosyncratic among states?
I have not really looked enough to see how idiosyncratic it is among states versus regional. I think Tennessee also sort of is one that looks good on this regard in terms of flatness. And maybe Kentucky does too. I'm sort of thinking of the ones that stand out in my memory. So it may be a little bit regional, but I haven't dug into it in detail.
If it is, you might expect the slope to be shallower in the early grades and gradually increase. Right. It has more of an impact.
Yeah, if it's driven by sort of state investments, say in early childhood education, that are funding public pre-K and making high-quality preschool available to low-income kids, right? You'd expect more equal outcomes early, but if the K-12 system weren't as equalizing, right, then you might expect it to sort of degrade in the way that we see in Virginia. So one of the things we're sort of looking into now is what can we learn about this from this variation across states, which is something you can't really do without this sort of population level data, because you can't get that gradient in every state and over each grade to kind of tease it out, right?
Is it possible that this difference could be a function of the different way the districts are defined? I mean, in Virginia, you've got mostly countywide districts, right? So in essence, you're defining the community in Virginia as a county. And in California, in most instances, the community is being defined much more locally.
So that's an empirical question I don't know the answer to, but the answer is knowable, right? We could look and see. It would have to be something about some kind of equalizing efficiency of scale. That is, like, poor large districts are somehow better able to provide opportunities than equally poor small districts. And I don't have a clear theory in my head about why there's a sort of more equalizing benefit of a large district, but maybe someone who works in large district can tell me why. I don't, but you know, that's the sort of story you would need to tell, though. Because we're always comparing places, you know, vertically that are sort of equally poor, right? So for this to be the case, the poor ones in Virginia have to benefit from being sort of large relative to the ones in California. It's also not true that the ones in California are small. There's lots of large poor districts in California, equally large to the counties of Virginia. So it's not even just scale, it's got to be something about the kind of countiness of them, if that's a word. All right, in the interest of time, I'm going to show you a few more things. So this is now all districts in the United States, but I've broken out the data just to show you the average performance of children who are classified as not economically disadvantaged. So a caveat here, NCLB required all states and schools to report test scores, not just for the total population, but by subgroup, racial subgroups, gender, and also by a subgroup called economically disadvantaged. They let the states decide what economically disadvantaged meant. So every state not only has its own definition of proficient, but every state also can have its own definition of economically disadvantaged. Most states used free and reduced price lunch eligibility, but not all states. And we're in the process of doing some checking to see whether the results are sort of sensitive to what definition the states use and trying to think about that. So this right now is sort of not corrected for any of that. That is, whatever the state called economic disadvantage is what we're reporting. But for the most part, it's free and reduced price lunch eligibility. So you can see that in most school districts in the United States, even lots of middle class and poor ones, non-poor students in those districts score at or above the national average. Not everywhere. There are lots of, you know, there's a lot of smaller places down here where even the non-poor students score quite poorly. If we then look at how the poor students score, those are the yellow dots, in most school districts in the United States, the poor students score below the national average. In fact, the number of districts where the yellow dot is above the national average is quite small, and there's almost no large or medium large district where the poor students score at or above the national average. And the difference between these is more than two grade levels, generally speaking. So on average, there's a gap of roughly two grade levels between the poor and non-poor students within any given school district. Obviously, there's variation around that, but that's the kind of common pattern. Now, the other thing you might notice here is that these lines, these dashed lines are kind of the fitted lines through all this data, they slope upwards. So what should that tell you? That tells you that, on average, poor students in affluent districts have higher test scores than poor students in poor districts. Now, one way to interpret that is that there's some kind of contextual effect. That is, there's some benefit, given that you're poor, there's some benefit, that is, there's extra opportunity if you grow up in a more affluent community, whether that's because the school's provided or the community or whatnot. That's what sociologists would think of as a contextual effect, a neighborhood effect, a school effect, something, right? That is, given that you're poor, it's better off to be in an affluent place. The counter argument to that is that the poor kids in these places are a lot poorer than the poor kids in these places. That is, the average poor kid, you know, over here is probably a lot poorer, a lot more disadvantaged on than the average poor kid who's here. And so the slope of this line might be sort of biased a bit by the fact that we're not really comparing equally poor students here and to equally poor students here. So we're working on figuring out how to make some adjustments for that, sort of how to take into account the differences in the poverty rates or parents' education rates among the kind of economically disadvantaged people in different places to get a kind of better estimate of whether it's really better for low-income students to grow up in these communities than in those communities. My hunch is it will make the line a bit flatter, but I don't know how much flatter. So stay tuned. And then a similar picture is this. This is broken down by race. The white dots represent the average test scores of white students. The blue dots represent the average test scores of Hispanic students. And the yellow dots represent the average test scores of black students. And this scale here now is that same scale, except it's race specific. That is, a one here means if it's a white dot, it means that the white students' families in that school district have this level of socioeconomic status. A blue dot means the Hispanic students' families have that level. So that is, we're comparing kids of different races who have the same level of family socioeconomic conditions on average. So one thing you notice is that the yellow dots and to some extent the blue dots are all to the left of the figure. The white dots are largely on the right of the figure. That simply represents the fact that white families on average have much higher socioeconomic status than black or to some extent Hispanic families in the United States, right? So that's why there's this sort of separation this way. And then the vertical comparison is sort of a way of thinking about how much racial gap is there in performance or opportunity net of socioeconomic differences, because we're sort of at any point we're comparing kids of different races but of similar socioeconomic status. And you can see that there's still, I don't know if you can see these lines, but the lines through here are about a two-thirds or three-quarters of a grade level difference. So even among children of different races but from communities where their families have the same socioeconomic status, you still see this racial disparity, suggesting that there's some difference in opportunity, even conditional on socioeconomic conditions. All right, I'm going to skip that one. I'm going to show you, now this is the growth rate, so I was showing you the kind of levels of performance, but where do we have growth? So this is a map of the average growth rates from third to eighth grade of test scores in each district in the United States. Green, again, is faster than average growth. The darkest green is 25% faster growth than the national average. And the purple is 25% slower or more. And this picture doesn't quite have the same clear pattern. There's a lot more checkerboardness to it, if I can use that word. And if we zoom in on it, you can sort of see this. So this is, so you can look at Massachusetts up there. You've got, you know, lots of these outer ring sort of Boston suburbs that have very high levels. This is the levels map, right? Not the growth map. You can look at Washington, D.C., dark purple, very low test scores on average. Chicago, light purple, below average, Detroit, right? But when you look at the growth rates, first of all, the Boston area doesn't look as great relative to the national average. There are still some places with high growth rates, but a lot of them are just a little above the national average. Washington, D.C. has disappeared, right here. Washington, D.C. is right there. It has above average growth rates, even though it's got very low average test scores. Chicago has very high growth rates. Detroit's light purple, so a little below average, but not nearly as below average as you would assume from its levels, right? So the story about growth rates and performance is a very different story and very not very correlated with the patterns of levels. The places that have the highest average test scores don't necessarily have the highest average growth from third to eighth grade, What that means is that lots of the level difference is present by the time third grade comes around, right? That is, a lot of the inequality in levels and opportunity seems to happen before third grade. The variation in growth rates after third grade is not nearly so related to socioeconomic status. So this is our same socioeconomic status scale, but now this axis is the average growth rate relative to the national average. So one means the average student in that district gains one grade level of performance per grade. That's the average by definition. And 0.25 means the average student in that district grows 25% faster than the national average. And you can see there's a correlation. That is, on average, growth rates are a little bit higher among the affluent districts than the poor districts, but not nearly so stark as with the levels. This correlation is about 0.2 rather than the 0.8 we saw before. Here's Chicago and Baltimore and Union City again. So remember I showed you before, Chicago has high growth rates, even though it's started low. Chicago is a striking outlier on this, right? Chicago, like if you look at the main picture, there's no district anywhere near that big that has growth rates that high. So I was a little suspicious. But the nice thing about Chicago is that Chicago takes the NAEP-TUDA exam. So the NAEP-TUDA exam is the trial urban district assessment. It's the NAEP test given to representative samples of kids in 20 or so large districts. And so we can look at the NAEP-TUDA exam for Chicago, and we can compare the fourth grade scores of children in Chicago to the eighth grade scores 4 years later of children in Chicago. And we can say how big is the difference in scores for that cohort of kids in Chicago on the NAEP test, which is a low stakes test for which the incentives for any kind of test score inflation are much lower, right? And the striking thing is that Chicago has exactly this same outlier status on the NAEP-TUDA. That is, the difference between fourth and eighth grade scores in the NAEP-TUDA are about 20% more than they are on the national average in Chicago. So this is not an artifact of our data. This is in the NAEP data as well. Now, one thing that can cause these rates to be inflated, as I said, is if a school district retains a lot of students in grade, right? Chicago used to have, but doesn't anymore, have an extensive summer school grade retention policy. But think about the magnitude of this difference. Growing 20% faster means that children gain 6 years of test score performance in 5 years. That is, from third to eighth grade, they gain 6 years of performance, right? If you wanted to hold kids back so that they had 6 years of time to get that, you would have to retain every single kid in the city of Chicago 1 year between third and eighth grade in order to produce that estimate as an artifact of grade retention. And you'd have to then also be not doing it in any other school district in the country, because the national average would have to be based on 5 years. So there's no way that that number is entirely an artifact of sort of more grade retention in Chicago than in other places. I also asked Elaine Allensworth at the consortium in Chicago to get the retention data for Chicago for the relevant years. And Chicago has a very, very slightly, like less than 1% higher retention rate in the time period we're looking at than the kind of national average retention rate. So there's no way, I think, that this story is a differential retention rate story in Chicago. That's not to say I know what it is, but I think there's something real, because we see it in the TUDA data and in this data, that the performance increases much faster in Chicago than it does in other large districts and than most other districts in the country. And that says we ought to learn something from what's going on in Chicago, right? One of the nice things about these data is you can find interesting outliers and then think about places to go do more in-depth kind of case study work.
Are you able to look at variance in SES in this, as in how much? Because you might think of places that have a wider variance.
Yeah, so from the American Community Survey, we can get estimates of the variance in SES within a place. And then we can also get estimates of the variance in test scores within a place from our data. We haven't yet looked at how related those are to each other, or how much the variance in SES relates to things like growth rates. But but one could do that, sure. Yeah.
I just want to make sure I understand how the outcome is being constructed. If a district has a lot of students leave to go to private schools and say that they're the brightest students that leave to go to private schools, would you count that as having poor growth, or would you not use those students in the early years that leave in the later years?
So we can't tell which individual students come or go from the data. We can only see the aggregate performance of kids tested in that grade in that year. So if there were differential dropout rates in Chicago, where all the low-performing kids were dropping out before eighth grade, or all the low-performing kids were leaving and going to private school, and so the ones who are left have sort of disproportionately higher scores. But the dropout rates in Chicago before eighth grade aren't very big. I mean, most dropout happens post eighth grade, and so while there's some in Chicago, not nearly enough to sort of drive that train. And private school, I don't know yet. We haven't sort of looked into yet. But a lot of private school is the other way. Kids move from private school back to public school after eighth grade when tuition gets more expensive.
Since you raised replications with TUDA, and also raised the issue of inappropriate test prep, much of what you do with this database you can't do with RAPE, obviously, which is why you created this database, but some of it you could.
Right.
And I'm curious how often you've tried to replicate, because we know that the biases from inappropriate test prep are sometimes very large, and we have a modest amount of evidence suggesting that it's systematically related to both race and SES.
Mm-hmm.
Which could create a real bias, and I think it'd be a conservative bias for some of your work. But because the schools that are districts that are down here would be further down here, if my hypothesis is right. But your method of doing this, it seems to me, largely takes care of that variation between states, but it retains it within states.
Yes.
So have you tried replicating what you can to see how much of it holds up in NAEP?
We've done a few things. So we might not have done what you're thinking. What we've done is we construct our estimates based on the state test score data we have, and then the national and the main state level NAEP data. We never use the TUDA data at all in constructing these estimates. So then we say, how well did our estimates replicate the TUDA estimates for those 20 districts, and how well did they replicate it by subgroup? And Andrew can explain this, the results in detail some more time because I'm conscious of time, but the high level results are we get very close to the TUDA results for the full population of kids in a district, with the exception of a few districts. So Atlanta in 2009 looks way better in our estimates than it does in the TUDA data. In 2011, Atlanta looks a lot like the TUDA estimates. So what you can see in that is something that looks a lot like a cheating effect, right? But it's a huge effect. The difference in the difference between our estimates in 2009 and the NAEP TUDA estimates are on the order of about a fifth of a standard deviation, which represents a massive amount of cheating or other manipulation, if that's what drives it, right? So there's a few districts where we see some deviances like that, but for the most part, they're within maybe a tenth or a twentieth of a standard deviation of what TUDA tells us. So that suggests, you know, A, we do a pretty good job in a kind of a high-level sense. That is, you wouldn't want to make fine-level distinctions between districts in different states based on these data, because there is this kind of uncertainty. But the other thing to think in mind is, this isn't magic. This replicates whatever problems you think there are in state testing systems are in this. This doesn't have any way of getting rid of them. It has a way of getting rid of the differences between states and to some extent between grades and across time as well, right? But whatever problems you think there are, and we, like you, think there are plenty of problems, in the state assessments themselves and what they measure and how they measure it. Those are all still present in the data. But, you know, at some level, the high-level results here and aren't driven by that, the relationship between socioeconomic status and outcomes and stuff like that, is largely immune to sort of that. I mean, it may change that slope a little bit or that correlation a little bit, but it's not going to, it's not what's driving that big pattern we see. The other thing we could do, and we haven't yet, is sort of take what Martin Carnoy and folks have done and take the NAEP data and try to do this kind of analysis with it, and we can, to some extent, see if we replicate the high-level patterns. But you can't do anything district-level with NAEP, and so it's limited in terms of doing that.
But I think it'd be valuable to do it at a more aggregate level.
Yeah. I'm conscious that I'm out of time, and I wanted to show you this one or two more things. So this is the poor, non-poor. Remember I showed you before there's this big difference in levels. There's not that much of a difference in growth rates. There's a little bit, but it's on the order of, you know, 3 to 5% difference in average growth rates between poor and non-poor students, conditional on their socioeconomic status. So within a district, there aren't large differences in growth rates between poor and non-poor kids. The big differences are in their levels when they get to third grade. So one of the takeaways in lots of this stuff is that more of the action is in the levels at third grade and the differences between groups and the differences between districts at third grade than is in differences in growth rates from third to eighth grade. So if you're sort of thinking about where the action is, if you're thinking about what might be the plausible explanations for this or what might be the right kind of policy levers to think about changing, they may not be, you know, in the kind of late elementary, middle school years, the early childhood years, whether that's, you know, 0 to 3 or pre-K or K to 3 or all of the above, is we can't say because our data starts at grade 3. But what is clear is that if you wanted to substantially reduce educational inequality, you probably ought to be thinking about how to do it before third grade and probably earlier. Other data like ECLS suggests that there's a lot of movement in inequality in the first couple years of school, so that the K to 2 years might really be a salient point. But a lot of it's sort of baked in by third grade, and certainly one could think about moving the needle in the third to eighth grade years. And when I talk tomorrow, segregation really matters in those years. So it's not that there's nothing you could do in those years. But the lion's share of the action is sort of there by third grade. And so that suggests that real efforts to significantly reduce inequality have to include some major component that thinks about early childhood and the early elementary years. I'm going to leave it there since I'm out of time, but thank you all very much.